So hello, everyone. The sea of green would make President Genschaff very, very pleased. She enjoys seeing green. And the regalia is wonderful as well. So thank you very much. And thank you all for being here today. We're here for two reasons. One is to commemorate the 100th anniversary of the 1916 Easter Rising in Dublin. And we're also here to recognize Jim Harkness, for the wonderful donation that he gave us of Irish materials for our special collections. And we really appreciate that. So thank you, Jim. Today, one of our speakers, our keynote speaker, is our own Matt Knight. Matt is the assistant director for special collections here. I don't know what it is about him, but for some reason, he really likes Irish stuff. And so he and Dr. Jenny Dukes Knight, who has some relationship to him, as I understand it, they taught a course this semester called The Irish in America. And this particular semester, the partnership between Jenny and Matt was so excellent because they were able to make use of a lot of the special collections materials that were donated by Jim and that were donated throughout the years. And that's a nice opportunity for our students to put hands-on primary research materials and to learn firsthand what history is all about. So that was a wonderful opportunity. So without further ado, I'm going to turn it over to Matt and let him take us down the road. And again, thank you all for being here. Thank you for braving parking. This is the week where it's final exam week and students we haven't seen for several months have shown up. And so it's kind of a challenge, but we appreciate you being here and braving that challenge. Thank you.
Thanks, Todd. And thank you, everyone, for coming. We didn't have any way to put a 100-year commemoration on a different week, so we do apologize again for the parking, and thank you all for coming. Today, we do celebrate the donation of the materials, Jim Harkin's personal papers and his books, as well as commemorate America's role in the 1916 Easter Rising. So first, allow me to say a few words about James J. Harkins. Jim Harkins, it's hard to call you anything but Jim. Jim has been a friend, a great friend of the USF Libraries for many, many years, and has become a personal friend of mine in just a short while. I can't say how much he's meant to the growth of Irish studies here at USF, and especially to the growth of Irish studies in the Special Collections Department. It's wonderful to have him as a friend of the library and a friend of the university. And before I invite Commissioner Stacy White up to say a few words about Jim, I'd like to just talk about his early life. Jim's grandfather, James, was born in 1832 on Inishkeel in Donegal, where his forefathers were sent in 1609. In 1828, after Catholic emancipation, the Harkin family began its societal comeback through farming and blacksmithing, intermarrying with a prominent cattle trading family. In 1880, Jim's father, James III, was born in Mount Charles and was instilled with an understanding of Irish history and folklore that, of course, he passed on. In 1900, James III joined his sister in America, and with their hard work, success came. In 1930, on a visit to Donegal, he married the daughter of a County Monaghan schoolmaster. Their son, James IV, was born in Atlantic City. Like his father, he created his own destiny, taught himself German, and in 1972, the US Air Force chose him as a principal organizer and press officer for Neil Armstrong's German visit. Later, he was selected as Allied General Staff's liaison, and on a visit to Ireland, Jim met Brian Bonner, a noted Donegal historian who counseled Jim to use his German expertise along with his special reader privilege cards with Irish and Continent Archives to research the influence of Eastern Mediterranean monasticism on the Irish medieval church. The fruit of that labor can be found at the back table, compliments of Jim Harkin. So please do, there's my lovely wife Jennifer Knight holding up the book for you. So that is some of Jim's family history and early life. I do invite Commissioner Stacy White to say a few words about Jim, and thank you so much for taking time out of your busy schedule. Much appreciated.
Mr. Harkins, if you'd like to come join me here at the podium. You know, it's a real honor and privilege for me to be here today. And aren't we just thankful for philanthropists like Mr. Harkins that supports academic endeavors of students here at USF, professors, researchers, academians. We're just so thankful for this collection, this fine collection that he's provided to the university. So I'm Stacy White, one of the seven county commissioners in Hillsborough County. I represent the area in which Mr. Harkins lives, so I'm his commissioner. And it's, again, a pleasure for me to be here today with a commendation from the board that I would like to read into the record and present to Mr. Harkins. It's a commendation for James Joseph Harkins IV, Esquire. And his Irish name is printed on here as well. I'm not even going to attempt to read that. But it goes on to read that the Hillsborough County Board of County Commissioners is pleased to recognize James Joseph Harkins IV, Esquire, for his dedication to preserving history in Hillsborough County, and thanks him for his generous contribution to the University of South Florida Special Collections Library. An internationally accomplished Irish historian, renowned as an author, lecturer, and world traveler, Mr. Harkins has worked tirelessly to preserve Florida history. He was founder and organizer of the Florida Catholic Heritage Trail, appointed to the State Elderly Affairs Advisory Council, a trustee of the Tampa Bay History Center, Hillsborough County Library Board Emeritus, and member of the Historical Review Board. As founder of the South Shore Roundtable, Mr. Harkins' love for Florida is matched only by his lifelong bond with Ireland as an elected life member of the Donegal Historical Society and Military History Society of Ireland. Mr. Harkins has donated his collection of antique books on Irish history, as well as his private academic papers, to the University of South Florida's Special Collections Library to commemorate the centennial of the 1916 Easter Monday Uprising in Dublin City, which eventually led to the creation of the independent Irish Republic. The Board of County Commissioners of Hillsborough County, Florida, does hereby commend James Joseph Harkins IV, Esquire, for his commitment to keeping Florida's history alive and for his activism in expanding awareness about the Irish culture through his charitable contribution. And it's dated today, the 27th day of April, 2016, signed by all seven of the commissioners. Mr. Harkins, my pleasure to present this to you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you, Commissioner, for the very nice words. What I'd like to do, Commissioner, is if you would step forward, I'd like you to present to you a Harkins Medal. This is a medallion of our hereditary coat of arms.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you very much,
it's
sir.
An honor. Thank you.
And now, ladies and gentlemen, I have to put on my glasses. There's an old Irish saying that there's no use being blind if you can't show it off. Matt, thank you for organizing this. Distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, I'd like to say hello to everybody. Thank you for coming. I would also like to recognize several people. One is my twin brother, who is sitting in the back. And the next is my former fiance, my wife of almost 50 years, Krista, who has attempted in vain to keep me on the straight and narrow. And lastly, I'd like to recognize Adam Moore. Adam, would you please stand up? There are not many guest speakers here that can stand and address a crowd where your great-grandson is a freshman at USF. Adam, you're running with the bulls. So, now the glasses. Good grief, I could see it. Today we commemorate and celebrate Irish American history, reflecting on the sacrifices of those intrepid women and men of 1916, whose uprising would eventually result in an independent Republic of Ireland. Secondly, and most important of all, we take pause to reflect that the participants involved in those momentous events which took place in Dublin City that Easter Monday morning, stood on the shoulders of those freedom fighters that preceded them. In other words, Clark, McDermott, McDonough, Pierce, Kent, Connolly, and Plunkett, stood on the ecumenical shoulders of McCorley, Murphy, Orr, Tone, and those rebels of 1798 and 1803. We should also recognize that America's freedom's torch was always Ireland's guiding light. In 1803, Robert Emmet, in a speech from the dock, said, "I wish to secure for Ireland what Washington secured for America." In 1968, my generation stood on the shoulders of America's great civil rights leader, Dr. Martin Luther King Jr., whose "I Have a Dream" speech inspired the creation of the Northern Ireland Civil Rights Association, modeled on his nonviolent principles. Thus, our signature became "Chucky Allah, our day will come." Sadly, like many that came before, nonviolence would be unsuccessful until that one day peace and civil rights began to emerge in Northern Ireland. As a historian, I am convinced that libraries such as the one we celebrate today will provide a shoulder for other generations to stand on to study the history of Ireland. USF has 3/4 of my multi-language history books and lecture papers. I am presently sorting out a myriad of texts that I have penned for the last 40 years, and soon special collections will have it all. As hereditary steward, I cannot give USF our O'Harkins patent. However, I can present you, Matt, with a copy of Burke's Peerage International Registry of Arms, where I am listed on page 4. Today we are joined with key members of the Ancient Order of Hibernians in America, the largest Irish Catholic organization in the world. Organized in 1836, in that long dark night of the Know Nothing movement that wanted to prevent the Irish Catholics from getting citizenship, that they were strangers in their land, they would fail. The AOH, in practical terms, is America's oldest civil rights organization. With their Jewish brethren, the Irish organized America's labor movement, and the great Felix Frankfurter so admired the Ancient Order of Hibernians and their distinctive structure that Frankfurter told the Zionist movement in America, "Please organize yourself like the AOH to be successful." Another accomplishment not very well known. Frankfurter probably said that because he remembered that the founder of our church had a Jewish mother. That said, it is my distinct honor to introduce Greg Sean Canning, AOH National Officer and National Co-Chairman for Freedom of All Ireland, James Cahill, President of AOH Florida, Rosemary Riley, president of the Ladies AOH Hillsborough County, and Thomas T. Harding, president of the AOH Hillsborough, who will present appropriate accolades to Special Collection. Ladies and gentlemen, would you please stand forward?
Thank you and good afternoon. Just a bit before I actually do the presentation, and I have a few words of my own to say about the commemoration of the East Horizon. But first of all, my name in English is Greg John Canning, and Irish it's Grí Hoshán O'Connanon, much easier to pronounce than the English. But the Ancient Order of Hibernians, as Jim said, was established here in the United States in 1836, but that's only the American branch of the Ancient Order. Ancient Order first was established in Ireland, with our roots going back to the 15, 1600s. It's actually the oldest Irish organization in the world. And we are currently in Ireland, the United Kingdom, Canada, the United States, Australia, and now New Zealand. And the reason for Hibernia, Hibernia is the Latin word for Ireland. And you have to understand, up until after Angormore, the Great Hunger, in the late 1800s, most Irish people spoke very little to no English. We basically spoke Irish and Latin. The only place in Ireland where English was really spoken was in and around Dublin, what we call the Dublin Pale. But once you stepped out of that, English really was not spoken. So that's the meaning a little bit behind the name of our order. As the national director for the Ancient Order of Hibernians overseeing the southern states, and as the co-national chairman for Freedom of All Ireland, I have a couple of words here that I would love to present, Matt, if you would accept it. The first one is a certificate of appreciation, and it says, presented to USF Tampa Library Special Collections for your support in establishing an Irish Studies collection and for your observance of the 100th anniversary of the 1916 Easter Rising in Dublin, Ireland. And this is from issued from me as National Director and from FFAI, Freedom for All of Ireland. I also have another presentation from the National Board. This one is from our National Historian, Mike McCormick, and our National President, Brendan Moore. And it says, Certificate of Appreciation presented by the Ancient Order of Hibernians to the Special USF Library Special Collections and the USF History Department in recognition of the support given to promoting the study of Ireland, the teaching of Celtic and Irish American history, and establishing the James J. Harkins Collection, presented this 27th day of April, 2016. Congratulations. And last is a framed copy of the Easter Proclamation that I'm going to just briefly talk about. And for anyone that's interested, out on that back table there in the folder are copies of the proclamation if you would like to take it home. Again, thank you. This proclamation is of special importance, and it's well worth reading for a couple of reasons. First of all, It is the very first Declaration of Independence ever written by a country to proclaim not only the rights of its men, but the rights of its women. And it proclaimed equal rights and justice for all of the citizens of Ireland, regardless of their ethnic background or religious persuasion. It's a document well worth reading. And 100 years ago on Easter Monday, April the 24th, after parading down Sackville Street, now known as O'Connell Street, 1,250 members of the Irish Volunteers and Irish Citizen Army, including 200 of Ireland's women, not often mentioned, marched down, and upon reaching central Dublin, began to secure prominent buildings, including the GPO. Can you imagine the look on their faces on that Easter Monday at 12:20 p.m. when, after taking possession of the GPO, the General Post Office, the birthplace of the Irish nation, they unfurled on top of that roof the first tricolour to fly over Dublin and Ireland, and along with it, a plain green flag, written on it, Irish Republic. Oh my God, the look on their faces. Considering many of them are Anglo-Irish, first thoughts in their mind, what are these hooligans up to now? The only thing I would say about the Easter Rising, it was doomed for failure. When they marched down, all they had was a day's rations, that's all. Limited ammunition and guns. And you have to understand, that was no match against superior British artillery, tanks and guns, gunboats. They were no match. But those men and women held out for a week. And they finally surrendered only when the ammunition ran out. And 100 years ago today, Easter Thursday, as they began to fire the shells on the buildings of central Dublin, and they began to heat up, fires began to spread, and on both sides of the GPO, and the glass came raining down as molten glass. And then 100 years ago tomorrow, those buildings began to collapse. And as those buildings began to collapse, men, women, and children that had taken refuge in those basements fled out onto the streets to open barrage of bullets. For the soldiers were ordered to shoot the civilians as they escaped because they would not take a chance that they were members of the Citizen Army or the Volunteers that had changed their uniforms to civilian clothes. And what I like to say is the brutality of the suppression of that rebellion and the subsequent execution of its founding fathers is what woke the Irish people up. And what spread throughout Ireland was the Irish War for Independence, which led to the creation of the Free State in 1922 and the unfortunate partition of my country, the eventual rejection of Ireland's Dominion status as part of the British Empire in the 1930s, and then finally with the establishment of a new constitution in December of 1948, the independent sovereign Republic of Ireland was established in January of 1949. But what I want to say is when you take a look at this document and you reflect on this week, remember this. The aspirations, the dreams, and the endeavors of these founding fathers who gave their lives for their country, and there is no honor greater than putting your life on the line for one's country. those aspirations have not been realized. There are still six counties in the north of Ireland, including my own county, where the flag of a foreign country flies over Irish soil. But things are changing. Times are changing. When my family and I left Ireland in 1960, we native Irish were a minority in our own land. We were a minority. Today, it's 2016. And in four of those six counties, we native Irish are now the majority. Derry, Fermanagh, Tyrone, Armagh. And while we may not yet command a majority in Antrim and Down, we do command the majority of Belfast, which is in Antrim. Ladies and gentlemen, times are changing. When I left Ireland in 1960, there was no equal economic opportunity. If you were native Irish, you were denied access to jobs. Most Irish men were on the dole, unable to find work, only because we were native Irish. What happened? Many were forced to emigrate, including my own family, keeping the native Irish population down. But thanks to the United States of America, American involvement, the Good Friday Agreement, and the McBride Principles, which I'm proud to say was reinstated here in Florida in April, the barriers towards equal economic opportunity has been broken down. Times are changing. When I was a young boy, we weren't allowed to speak our own language. Could you imagine as Americans not being allowed to speak American English on American soil? We weren't allowed. One of my close friends, 20 years my senior, you know, I'm only 35, but 20 years my senior, when she went to school, the nuns decided they were going to begin their day in prayer using our language. When the authorities found out, within 5 days, there were troops at the school. And when the children went in, they placed a soldier in each classroom. The minute they began using the Irish, they shut the school down. Today, because of the Good Friday Agreement, we can now use our own language. And not only can we use our own language, it's spreading rapidly throughout the North. 20 years ago in all of Ireland, there were only about four or five schools that taught in the Irish. Today there are now over 400. Ladies and gentlemen, times are changing. And my closing words, if you went back to the 1940s or early 50s, the native Irish population in the north of Ireland, we were somewhere in around the 30s, mid-30s, 35-37%. No more. Now, in 2016, the nationalist Irish native population of the north of Ireland is now around 47-48%. Unionist is about 52-53%. And of that, the overwhelming majority of those 35 years and younger are native Irish. If the trend continues with the continued intervention of this great country and the continued implementation of the Good Friday Agreement and the McBride Principles, we expect within 18 years to 20 to have an overwhelming majority throughout all six. And at that time, we can look forward to the removal of the last foreign flag over Irish soil. My only wish is that when that happens, I'm still alive. And I told my wife, and I told my children, I could be in a coma. I could be on the bed in the hospital with all tubes coming in. You cut the tubes, get a stretcher, put me aboard plane, because I want to be able to be on the streets of my city when my city and county is once again part of my country. Kuramahaga, thank you. This time, if I can ask the Florida State President, Jim Cahill, to please come up. And also, I'd like to recognize sitting over here in our audience is Bob Chris, the Florida State Treasurer. Thank you, Jim.
I think Greg Sean used up my 3 minutes. But he's a hard act to follow. I'd like to say a few things about the Irish impact in Florida. When most people think of an Irish cultural center in the United States, you wouldn't think of Florida, but Florida has the fifth largest Irish population in the United States. In the 2010 census, over 15 million people identified themselves as having Irish ancestry. And most of the early Irish came here as soldiers, all the way back to the Spanish, when Florida was part of Spain. Two Irish mercenary regiments who fought for Spain were the Tercia Irlanda, which was the Spain's Irish Brigade, and the Regimento Hibernia, which was known as the O'Neill Regiment, were both Irish mercenaries. And when their services were done here in Florida, a lot of them stayed. If you look around the state, you'll see a lot of Irish influence. There's several Dublins, Shamrocks, cities named for the Irish heritage. There's a Hibernia in Clay County, small town. In Lake County, there's a Kilkenny, and there's a Killarney there, right outside. So there's a big Irish influence in Florida, I'm proud to say that. I've known Jim for about 6 years. He's been a mentor to me, and want to congratulate him on his generosity to the university. And on behalf of the state, I'd like to present this flag. Thank you.
I will be brief. My name's Tom Harding. I'm the successor to Jim Harkins as the president of the AOH Division I in Hillsborough County. And I was going to give Commissioner White one of my family coins. But seeing that my family was a bunch of sheep stealers from Mayo, don't have a coin to give. But we're here today to honor our good friend, Jim Harkins. He has been a very active member of the Ancient Order of Hibernians for many years and has raised the visibility of the organization in our community considerably. Further to that, we're very proud of Jim's intellectual curiosity and dedication to understanding Irish history, which has resulted in quite a collection of documents, books, and of course now University of South Florida is the wonderful recipient of all of that. So we congratulate him on that, and we are very happy that the University of South Florida has such distinguished people to accept everything. I have to tell you one little story before I present something here. Jim and his brother Peter are very well known to be very astute thinkers, and they received a Victoria's Secret catalog some weeks ago. And Peter said to Jim, well, those are fine-looking women. And Jim said, well, look at this. There's a price under each one of them in the catalog. I think I'll get me one of those. So Peter calls Jim up a week later and says, well, did she arrive yet? And he said, no, not yet, but her clothes have, so she's on her way. One last thing. Just as one example of the kind of dedication to Irish heritage and Irish history, Jim visited with the county commissioners and was able to request and receive a proclamation declaring Irish Heritage Month in the county of Hillsborough last month. And we were very proud of him for having accomplished that. This is a copy of that presentation. We'd like to give it to Matt.
Good afternoon. I'm president of the Ladies Order of Ancient Hibernians, Division I, Hillsborough County. We have Jennifer and Matt. Bridget is our historian. Bridget will now present Jennifer with a pin of the Easter Rising, commemorating the Easter Rising. And on behalf of the Ladies Order of Ancient Hibernians, Division I, Hillsborough County, to honor the women who fought in the 1916 Easter Rising, we would like to present to you the 2016 National Pin and offer our commemorative war memento to the Irish Collection. In honor of the new James J. Harkins Personal Library to the Irish Collection, the Ladies Ancient Order of Hibernians would like to present this check in the amount of $500 to the USF Library and Department of History for the development of the Irish Studies.
That couldn't be here today. We are in class. Don't want you to think it was a class of 45 with two other auditors, so it was very, very successful.
And now it's my great pleasure to welcome to the podium another great, great friend of the library and the Special Collections Department, a pillar of the community, and just a lovely man. E.J. Salsinas, will you please join us up here? I think you may have something from the mayor.
Former USF President Betty Castor, Dean Chavez, Your Excellencies, ladies and gentlemen, nobles all. It's my pleasure to be here with you today. And before I read this beautiful proclamation, which Tampa's very proud Irish American mayor dedicates for this special occasion, Let me remind you all that very soon, in less than 5 years, Florida will celebrate the bicentennial of Spain ceding the state of Florida to the United States. And let me remind you, those of you that are keen in your Irish history, that the last four governors of Spanish Florida were Irish Spaniards. Governor Kindelan, Governor Copinger, the Spanish way of pronouncing Coppinger, Governor White, and the eminent Alejandro O'Reilly. The next time you visit Havana, make sure that you walk down the streets, especially, as the Cubans pronounce it, O'Reilly. But it's O'Reilly. Yes, it's absolutely true that Spain welcomed the Irish. And even today in Spain, we still have the Irish College in the very famous university called Salamanca. So the mayor brings to you through my message a personal good wish and sends this very special proclamation for this very important day. Whereas, founded in 1956, the University of South Florida is one of the largest public and global research universities in the United States, and it delivers outstanding, internationally recognized programs for undergraduates, graduates, professionals, and the greater community. And whereas, founded in 1962, the University of South Florida Libraries Special Collections Department was established to develop both a research collection in Florida history and a general monographic collection to house rare and special items that were acquired through the USF Library. And whereas the USF Library's Special Collections Department supports the research and teaching missions of the university by acquiring, preserving, and providing access to select and targeted monographs, manuscripts, illustrations, maps, sheet music, photographs, archival materials, printed ephemera, audio and video images and texts in selected digital formats, and the collections are available to the university community and the general public. And whereas, committed to the study of Irish history, the USF Library Special Collections added Irish studies to its collections through the donation of the personal papers and research library of James J. Harkins IV, and the USF Department of History has designed and is offering new courses in Irish history, Celtic history, the Irish in America, the Irish history from St. Patrick to 1922, furthering the enhancement of USF students' global competencies and the mission of the Global Citizens Project. And whereas, in commemoration of the 100th anniversary of the April 27, 1916, Easter Rising in Dublin, Ireland, USF Libraries is featuring a lecture entitled America's Fantastic Hearts, the role of the United States in the Easter Rising by Matthew Knight, Irish scholar and assistant director of the USF Library Special Collections, an acknowledgement of the generous donation of the Irish Studies Collection from Mr. Harkins today, Wednesday, April 27, at this USF Library in this Grace Allen Room. Now, therefore, I, Bob Buckhorn, by virtue of the authority vested in me as mayor of the city of Tampa, do hereby proclaim today, Wednesday, April the 27th, 2016, as USF Irish Studies Day in the city of Tampa. And I urge all citizens to join me in thanking the USF Libraries and Department of History for making the rich Irish history available to all citizens in our community through its Irish Studies courses and collection, done and ordered this day in Tampa, Florida, and signed Bob Buckhorn. I now present this to Matt. Aaron Gobra.
Thank you so much, EJ. If I knew I was going to be mentioned in that, I would have stepped up my contributions. 100 years ago today, the Easter Rising was in its fourth day. Still raging, but the net had begun to close in on the rebels. Now, what does that mean to us today, 100 years later? Certainly, in many countries across the world, there have been a lot of commemorations last month and this month. It's interesting that the Irish celebrated the feast day we go with the calendar, but here we are. They celebrate them in different ways. They say, was the rising justified? Some events show music and poetry inspired by the rising. Others have established guest panels to talk about the many issues. But one word comes up in all these events, or most of these events, and that's reconsidering. So today, we can look at a commemoration of a centenary like this as an opportunity to refocus our long-held views and reflect upon the ways we not only interpret historical events, but maybe see if we can challenge our acceptance of a historical narrative. So today, I hope we can all consider the rising in terms of the influence of the Irish Americans, not just on the rising itself, but on the establishment of American Republican nationalism in the US that carried on for decades and led to the events of 1916. After this brief talk, hopefully it will be a little more apparent why the United States is the only other country mentioned in the proclamation of the Irish Republic delivered by Padraig Pearse just after noon on Easter Monday, 1916. Most studies of Irish American nationalism start with the exiled rebels of 1848 or the famine refugees. But there was an earlier group of Irish emigrants who fostered a deep-seated animosity towards Britain and also harnessed Irish nationalism in the US. I refer to the United Irishmen who arrived in the US between 1795 and 1806. Roughly 2,000 radical exiles left Ireland for the US before and after the failed rebellion of 1798. This rebellion, led by Theobald Wolfe Tone, was an attempt to attain independence for Ireland on a platform of tolerance. All religions, all classes needed to unite as Irishmen. Without going into great detail, the rebellion was not a success. The philosophy of tolerance did not hold, and Wolfe Tone committed suicide rather than be executed by the British. But those United Irishmen who fled for the US before and after the rebellion were also Catholic and Protestant, and their desire for an Irish independence often trumped religious divisions, and they preached this tolerance in the US. This group helped foster in the US a sense that an independent Ireland needed to have the American example of republicanism at its heart, and they hoped to transform frustrated aspirations in Ireland into fulfilled expectations in America. They were the American link to France in 1798, and they plotted and ran guns for that effort and for the Robert Emmet Rebellion in 1803. They also helped recent Irish immigrants by establishing patriotic societies, promoting Irish culture, publishing pamphlets, and mainly keeping the Irish informed about what was going on back in Ireland. They ensured that a nationalist ideology was being formed in the US. So when the next wave of exiled US Irish revolutionaries came, they were stepping into an established tradition of Republican nationalism. So after peaceful movements for Catholic emancipation and repeal of the Act of Union were led by Daniel O'Connell, modern Irish nationalism began to take a different form with the Young Ireland movement in the 1840s. These individuals took the inclusive nationalism of Wolfe Tone and the United Irishmen and grafted it onto a desire to bring back the customs and the lore of Ireland, argued that the Irish were truly a separate race from the British. And this distinction found its way into Irish America as well, where the Irish immigrants really gladly adopted this Celt versus Saxon mentality. They called them Saxons, may have been more Normans, but the point is, Celt is on the one side and Britain on the other. Events soon led to the Young Ireland movement becoming more revolutionary. The famine struck Ireland in 1845, and by 1847, British inaction and mismanagement caused an outcry. Then, in February of 1848, when revolution broke out in Paris, these events touched off a wave of similar revolts throughout Central Europe, and immediately a revolutionary fervor hit Europe, Ireland, and the US. It was in this year that Thomas Francis Marr designed the Irish tricolor in tribute to the French revolutionaries, and Young Ireland turned its eyes towards rebellion. But so did supporters in the US. The United States was the first government to officially recognize the French provisional government, and Irish nationalists in America capitalized. The Irish Republican Union was formed in New York to, quote, promote revolutions for the establishment of republican governments in Europe, especially in Ireland. And they hoped to form an Irish brigade to join these revolutions. But the point was clear. The Irish in America wanted a new independent Ireland formed and forged by the republican values found in the United States. As one converted rebel, Thomas Mooney, stated, to, quote, plant the republican tree of liberty on the hill of Tara. But by the time the Americans got around to raising money and discussing secret invasions from America, the promised rebellion of 1848 had already ended. The Young Islanders were scattered. More than 3,200 men were imprisoned or exiled, and many fled to the United States. This influx of revolutionaries of 1848 and the massive wave of Great Hunger immigrants furnished Irish nationalism in the US with an intensity beyond that seen in other nations of the Irish diaspora. The Irish American nationalism that formed is truly unique. Nowhere else did nationalism get so much support and militant and radical fervor than in the US. Between 1841 and 1851, a human bridge was really formed between Ireland and the US, with the immigration of more than 1 million people of Irish birth to America. They were disappointed in the events of 1848, but these revolutionaries still hoped that an uprising could take place in Ireland in the not too distant future. Irish American military companies started to be formed. In New York, thousands of Irishmen were enlisted in these exclusively Irish regiments. And this set a pattern for other states. And you have to remember, there were not other immigrant groups marching up and down the streets of New York in full uniform declaring that they were going to fight for the freedom for whatever country they came from. This was truly unique and would have been a sight to see. But they wanted to put this military training for use in a rebellion back in Ireland. There were revolutionary plans hatched, each of them at this point relying on England's difficulty would be Ireland's opportunity. For example, some nationalists sought Russian support during the Crimean War, and in 1855, they were actually pretty close, but the Treaty of Paris ended up quashing the plans. John O'Mahony was pretty close getting Russian support. But the most important organization to form in the US in the 19th century was the Fenian Brotherhood. It was formed by John O'Mahony in 1858-59, and this group was the American wing of the Irish Republican or Revolutionary Brotherhood, which was founded in Dublin on St. Patrick's Day in 1858. James Stevens was the ultimate leader of both the IRB and the Fenians, although O'Mahony controlled the American Fenian Brotherhood as head center. The name, of course, harkens back to the ancient Irish Fianna, the warriors of Ireland. It can be seen in the national anthem, Aran na Fian. And this Fenian Brotherhood was there to arm and train, and more importantly for Stevens, raise money, waiting for the opportunity to strike for Irish freedom. About 40 regiments and companies were formed or controlled by the Fenians in America, among them the Phoenix Brigade, the Emmet Guards, the 69th Regiment, we've probably all heard, the Irish Brigade, and Corcoran's Irish Legion. And these became household names after the Civil War broke out in 1861. Thousands of Irish Americans enrolled as privates in order to get that military experience for when they were called to fight for freedom back home. But let me move from the physical force to the public relations for a minute. In January of 1861, one of the participants in the 1848 rebellion, Terence Bellew McManus, died in San Francisco. The local Fenians started to think that maybe they could use this to their advantage. They thought maybe they could use it as a catalyst for a great outpouring of nationalist sentiment in the US and back in Ireland. So McManus was adopted as a nationalist icon because he had suffered the life of exile and was a rebel in 1848. He was not a member of the Fenian Brotherhood, but at this point that doesn't matter. They exhumed his body and had it shipped to New York. In October of 1861, let's remember he died in January, with John O'Mahony as Grand Marshal leading the way, 32 pallbearers accompanied the casket through the streets of New York to the pier, where a steamer awaited and McManus's remains were placed on board. This was designed to create an awe-inspiring occasion and to garner as much publicity as possible for the Fenian Brotherhood. And this McManus funeral in New York succeeded in all aspects, but it was only the beginning. The steamer was sent to County Cork. When it arrived, 8,000 people in a train a mile long escorted the body to the train station, where it then proceeded to Dublin. Contemporary police reports say 40,000 people met the cortege in Lower Abbey Street in Dublin. Then they moved to Glasnevin Cemetery, and 7,000 or 8,000 people were still there at the burial. This was a test of the revival of the fighting Irish national spirit, which had been thought dead after the famine and the 1848 rebellion. This funeral gave an enormous boost to Fenian morale and the IRB in Ireland. It was major propaganda value to the organization, and we'll see later, this type of event was not the only one of its kind. And this speaks to the title of the talk today. America's Fanatic Hearts comes from the poem by William Butler Yeats when he talks about, he says, out of Ireland have we come, great hatred, little room, maimed us from the start. I carry from my mother's womb a fanatic heart. And it's this fanatic heart we need to see when we think about, we won't get into detail about the failed Canadian risings. We won't get into some of these things that seem foolish and have been written as such in history books. These were fanatic hearts. They meant and they believed everything that they endeavored to do. But with the advent of the Civil War, Fenians on both sides of the Atlantic saw an opportunity. They had a mission. They would join either the Union or Confederate side, but they would gain this valuable military experience for when they were called for an insurrection. Of course, they did this, but it resulted in a radical depletion of Fenians on both sides as the Irish Brigade suffered horrendous losses throughout the conflict. It's been estimated that between 150,000 and 175,000 Irish fought for the Union armies and about 40,000 on the Confederate side. However, when they began to disband in 1865, hundreds of Irish Americans were true to their word, and they did travel to Ireland to participate in the rising due to take place in December of 1865. By the beginning of that year, reports were made that the Fenians were 60,000 strong in the US, with about 80,000 IRB members in Ireland, all waiting the word to go ahead for an insurrection. And really, an uprising in Ireland at the end of 1865 or the opening weeks in 1866 would have found the IRB in a strong military position, not just because of the numbers, but because of the Fenian infiltration of the British Army. These trained and disciplined soldiers from the British Army, along with the experienced American officers, had a very real potential to transform into a formidable fighting force. Of 26,000 regular troops that England had in Ireland, 60% were Irish, and it's estimated 8,000 of these were Fenians. Of the militia force of 12,000, half of them were Fenians, While in the army in England, the Fenians numbered 7,000. They just needed to be given the word. But at the very moment when the concentration of all efforts for Ireland was more necessary than ever, the Fenian Brotherhood in the United States split into two factions. One kept preparing for war in Ireland, the other for an invasion of Canada. This split effectively killed any hope of an independent Ireland at that time, though they didn't know that. Coupled with this split, for all his bluster, James Stephens failed to deliver on his hollow promises of immediate war in 1865, and against the advice of many American Civil War veterans, he postponed the rising in Ireland. To add insult to injury, in February 1866, the British, not for the first time, suspended the act of habeas corpus and arrested hundreds of Fenians, including about 150 of the 500 American officers there anxious to fight in the rebellion. They were apparently easy to spot them with their wide-brimmed hats and square-toed boots, so the Americans could have done better disguising. Still, the long-expected rising in Ireland did take place on March 5th, 1867, spurred on by many of these disillusioned Irish-American officers. But apart from a few skirmishes, it really came to nothing. Americans who were trying to help the cause sent a ship that changed its name to the Erin's Hope, loaded with weapons, but they found that by the time it arrived, the rebellion had already been over for a couple of months. The guns were captured. But with better planning and leadership, the arrival of these guns showed it could have been done if it were done right. If Stevens could have started a revolt in 1865, it would have been a formidable affair. But the failure of the 1867 rising and the failure of the Canadian raids and the gradual improvement of Anglo-American tempers after the Civil War were setbacks indeed. But the nationalist spirit lived on. In 1867, Clan na Gael was formed. It was established as Fenianism without the factions. And it was established as a secret society that actually remained secret. Should say the Fenian Brotherhood used to post their movements in the newspaper. They used to say when they were meeting and have picnics. It wasn't as secret as it could have been. But the Clan na Gael had learned some things. 7,000 members in 1874. By 1877, that increased to 11,000. John Devoy was one of its major leaders. And he was truly one of the most influential Irish Americans in terms of support for Irish freedom. And he'll be a major focus for the rest of this talk. Devoy was born in 1842 in County Kildare, and he joined the IRB as a teenager. He was arrested and tried for treason in 1866, but he was released in 1871 on a deal with four others that if you promise to get out of this country and exile yourself, you can leave prison. So he came to America as one of the Cuba Five, a group of other nationalist prisoners. And one of the other members on that ship, Cuba, Jeremiah O'Donovan Russa, also became a major leader of Fenianism in America, and they both were for the rest of their lives. But for the most part, the 1870s was a decade of relative inactivity. We don't need to get into the land leagues, but for Irish Republican nationalism, it was a slow period, perhaps. But regarding Clan na Gael, we can discuss two developments in the fight for Irish freedom, one that involved dynamite and the other a submarine. To the latter first, one of Clan na Gael's greatest schemes in 1881 was the attempt to utilize what they became known as the Fenian Ram, the first steam-powered submarine. John Holland tried to sell this design to the US Navy, but they refused. He later said that the naval captains couldn't march up and down and show off their medals on the decks, which is why they didn't take it. But he found a more willing buyer in Clan na Gael. However, before it was all paid off, a small group of over-anxious Klan members stole it before it was paid and towed it to New Haven, Connecticut. But when it got there, they realized no one knew how to operate it. So it was soon dumped in a shed in 1883. But had this small group just joined the rest and been a little more patient, it could have been the Fenians scuttling the British fleet instead of the German models doing so years later. A small group of Klan na Gael called the Triangle and our friend Jeremiah O'Donovan Russa adopted dynamiting campaigns against the British as their strategy for Irish independence. At least 17 dynamite missions were carried out from 1881 to 1885, and bombs were detonated at gasworks in Glasgow, the House of Commons, the Tower of London, the Palace of Westminster, and various other urban targets. These missions were partially funded by open contributions to a collection in the pages of the New York Irish World, edited by Patrick Ford. In 1883, a man using the name of Henry Wilson was sent by O'Donovan Russa to blow up London Bridge. He was caught and jailed for 15 years. His real name was Thomas Clark, and his role in the cause of Ireland's freedom has only just begun. These pictures are from a New York newspaper, by the way. This isn't your typical British satirizing of the Irish as with ape-like features. It was actually both of these published in New York. In the end, arrests, death, internal disputes, and the failures of dynamite as an agent of real change led to the end of this dynamite war by 1886. An interesting note is when you look at what was called the skirmishing fund, these contributions to the dynamite campaign, the names, almost more than 90% of them, all come from famine, refugees, or the relatives of them. There are no pre-famine immigrants who subscribe to this fund. So the memory of the Great Famine cannot be overstated as causes for this Republican nationalism in the US. In the 1880s, another basis for revolutionary action was emerging. These physical force Republicans began to take an interest in culture, and not the high art of the Irish literary revival when we think of figures like William Butler Yeats, although that was a very important movement, but rather looking back into the customs, folkways, ideas, and the language in order to create a deeper national consciousness. This was a moral and spiritual element that could strengthen the political. Bilingual journals like An Gael, begun in 1881 in New York, sprang up to promote the use and in some ways the resurrection of the Irish language. We think of Irishlár na Gaeilge in Ireland, but An Gael was a huge, huge influence. And there's a 1901 copy in the little display by the door if you want to look at that on the way out. Next, the Gaelic Athletic Association set out in 84 to revive traditional Irish sports on the contention that these imported English games, cricket and soccer, which was just beginning its conquest of the world, were alien to Irish heritage. But the movement had revolutionary implications. And despite their unwavering commitment to an independent republic, the IRB recognized that the GAA was a kindred movement. And it wasn't long until IRB members could be found at the highest levels of all the GAA societies. They banned the playing of any English games, and they soon identified with the other key cultural organization of the period, the Gaelic League. It was founded in 1893, and it set out an unprecedented wave of enthusiasm for language learning and for absorbing the culture of ancient Ireland. Douglas Hyde, who founded the League, he extolled nonviolence, but the very way he stressed de-Anglicization really led to a cultural war and inevitably stirred Republican sentiment in Ireland and the United States. This mixture of cultural nationalism and Republican nationalism is hugely important, and we'll see with many of the leaders of the Rising, they were intermixed, and this was vital. But this takes us back to John Devoy. By 95, Devoy was a naturalized US citizen, although his heart was always intent on working for an independent Ireland. With other Clan na Gael men like Joseph McGarrity and Judge Cathalan, Devoy despised the movement supporting home rule for Ireland. He felt it was a watered-down solution, and he wasn't alone. Only physical force could win Ireland's freedom. And all his efforts and all the efforts of his supporters in the Clan were put into achieving that goal. And this took up his entire life until the Rising. In 1903, he founded a newspaper called the Gaelic American, which openly caused for the Irish Americans to engage in the fight for freedom. It had a circulation of 28,000 and it was an unbelievable supporter of the cause. One of the editors of this newspaper was our friend Thomas Clark, the ex-dynamiter, recently freed from British prison after 15 years, and clearly one of the most patriotic Irishmen you could find. But after the outbreak of the First World War, a radical group called the Irish Volunteers, largely directed by the Irish Republican Brotherhood, began preparing for an insurrection proclaiming an Irish Republic. They were fed up with the collapse of home rule and failed promises, and there seemed to be no other alternative. And it was this group that was inextricably tied to Devoy and the other American Republican nationalists. Republican nationalism at this point really gained strength in the US in a large way, as they resented seeing Irishmen not only fighting for Britain against Germans, with whom they had no feud, but realizing that physical force nationalism was the only way forward. Funds raised in the US were shuttled to Ireland to be used by the IRB in any way necessary. And DeVoy himself estimated that in the years leading up to 1916, $100,000 was contributed to the cause of the IRB and Irish freedom by Clan na Gael and its supporters. $100,000, that's about $2.5 million in today's money. Of course, it was not just the Clan. Groups like the AOH also contributed. Aside from financial support, DeVoy instigated an effort to gain German funding for Irish freedom after the breakout of World War I. He and Irish nationalists on both sides of the Atlantic, they rightly viewed England's war with Germany as finally this is England's trouble, our opportunity. And so they courted Germany for help. DeVoy and other leaders met with a German ambassador to the US in August 1914. He asked them for a supply of arms and enough officers to get the cause going. He then funded Roger Casement's mission to Germany to procure arms and, more ingenious, to secure an Irish brigade from the Irish prisoners in Germany at the time. Clan na Gael also worked to promote anti-British feeling at home in order to prevent the entry of the US into the war. Woodrow Wilson's disingenuous nature can be omitted here, but suffice it to say that he, like President Johnson before him, didn't want Irish independence so much as he wanted Irish votes. Also in 1914, DeVoy took a leading role in promoting a lecture tour of the United States by Padraig Pearse. One of Pearse's biographers points to that trip as the time the future provisional president found his voice. He learned to communicate powerfully with mass audiences, and he discovered a natural aptitude for extreme rhetoric. He started the tour as a fundraiser for St. Enda's, his Irish language school. So he goes over in 1914 trying to raise money, and he's still a Home Rule supporter, and he comes back as one of the most revolutionary figures in Irish history. That trip to the US was vital. His voice, when he came back from America, was a weapon of its own. DeVoy was also involved in exploiting the funeral of the veteran Fenian Jeremiah O'Donovan Rossa. He died in New York in 1915, and on August 1st, they buried him in Glasnevin Cemetery. But once again, they realized that a dead Fenian in New York is not as important as a dead Fenian in Ireland. So they picked Padraig Pearse as the eulogist. They also filmed it. It was brilliant. This is 1915. Film isn't very common, but Clan na Gael had two rolls of film, which they broadcast about this event to use it as the propaganda piece as large as could. It was a brilliant strategy. Picking Pearse as the role of eulogist was brilliant as well. We should note that the Hibernian Rifles, formed from the American Alliance wing of the AOH, formed the honor guard at this event. Pearse's words, of course, are some of the most famous uttered by an Irishman ever, and serve more as a declaration of war than any type of panegyric. They think that they have pacified Ireland, he says. They think that they have purchased half of us and intimidated the other half. They think that they have foreseen everything, think that they have provided against everything. But the fools, the fools, the fools. They have left us our Fenian dead, and while Ireland holds these graves, Ireland unfree shall never be at peace. Now that's a declaration of war, not a eulogy. The Easter Rising was planned in secret by seven men, most of them IRB members who had formed a military council just after the outbreak of the First World War. These were Tom Clark, Sean McDermott, Padraig Pearse, Thomas McDonough, Plunkett, James Connolly, and Eamon Kyunt. DeVoy, however, was kept abreast of all these plans for the 1916 Rising. He was in the confidence particularly of Clark, Pearse, and Plunkett, and they held him in the highest reverence. If you look at the correspondence, when they write to DeVoy, these orchestrators of the rebellion are treating him as if he is the leader. The reverence is unbelievable. They call him Sean Farr, the old man, which is more reverential than for my old man. But anyway, it was in fact DeVoy who sent Tom Clark back to Ireland to orchestrate the insurrection. And Tom Clark was sent back by DeVoy. There's talk about his properties and things. He was sent back. And it was Tom Clark who was the real mastermind of Easter 1916. We can't get into all that today. We also need to remember that the US was a neutral power at the time. Only weeks before the Rising, the offices of Clan na Gael were ransacked by Secret Service members, and coded documents were stolen. It's a good bet that these documents were given to the British and aided them, for the shipment of arms from Germany that Roger Casement had arranged to be delivered was discovered by the British off the coast of Kerry and its cargo lost. But Irish America's role in the 1960 Rising was more than financial. Another facet was that many leaders of the rebellion traveled extensively or lived in the United States for a long period of time. Some were even American citizens. Thomas Clark and James Connolly had made lives for themselves, and about a half a dozen others, including Pierce, as we mentioned, and Sir Roger Casement, had made extended visits, and tours of the United States. In September of 1915, 8 months before the Rising, Joseph Mary Plunkett, another signatory of the proclamation, arrived in New York to meet with DeVoy and personally inform him about the plans for the Rising. Eamon de Valera, only the most important politician for the following two generations, was born in New York and had dual British-American citizenship. In the thick of the Revolution, America's community of exiles and their descendants were nothing less than a direct extension of this Irish cause, and its members saw themselves and were perceived as fully united in this struggle. So much so that the Times of London, when John DeVoy died, wrote his obituary judging him the most bitter and persistent, as well as the most dangerous enemy of this country that Ireland has produced since Wolfe Tone. And this is a man who spent most of his life in America, remember. He died in New York, but his body fittingly lies in Glasnevin Cemetery under a stone adorned with only three words: Fenian, rebel, patriot. It's been said many times that the Rising wouldn't have occurred without the financial and political support of Irish America, and America's reaction was crucial to determining the consequences of the Rising. The essential decisions related to the Rising were made in Ireland, but people in the United States played a significant role both before and after the rebellion, which is a lecture unto itself. Further, as we said, the proclamation was read on the first day of the Rising by Pierce, acknowledged the rebels were supported by her, Ireland's, exiled children in America. You can read these words in the display case by the door, and I think, as Greg said, there are some other handouts. But really, we need to see John DeVoy was largely responsible and behind a lot of those words in the proclamation. But before I conclude, I need to say that this is a commemoration, it's a commemoration of an event that served as a catalyst for the eventual independence of 26 counties in Ireland. But we're not here to celebrate bloodshed, but rather ask ourselves as we look back 100 years, what did 1916 mean to us as Americans? Historically, politically, and symbolically, as Robert Schmuel has just said, the Easter Rising in Ireland is our 4th of July. In both cases, independence from Great Britain took several years to achieve, required bloody combat, and tested many, many allegiances. But both the Easter Rising and July 4th mark points of no return, tipping points on the way to the creation of new and better nations. Thank you. Jimmy wants to say a few words.
Thank you very much. I think that was very enlightening. I just wanted to take about 4 microseconds to greet a very old friend. She was the president of USF when I used to do my lecture series, 1,000 Years of Irish History, here, and that's Betty Castor. Betty, it's just delightful to see you. When we wrap this up, I would like to get all the players up here, and we want to make a couple of pictures for a release to the National Hibernian, our newspaper that'll be is read throughout the United States and Canada. And I just want to thank everybody. I hope it's been an enjoyable couple of hours, and we hope that when you leave here, that you have a little more Irish in your heart and say, hey, maybe what can we do to foster and promote Irish studies at the University of South Florida? Because my desire is to make USF the epicenter of Irish studies in the state of Florida. Thank you very much.
Thanks, Jim. And for the interest of time, I can field questions afterwards rather than now. But one thing, Jim has told me many things over the months that I've known him, and I've never questioned any of his knowledge until today, where he said his name appears on page 4. It's page 3, Jim. Page 3. Thank you all so very much for coming. And
can we leave the people up here for
yes, and let's do the photos. Thanks, everybody. And there's still food and drink in the other room, I believe.
Greg, we'll meet you over there. What?
Wait a minute. I'm walking with you. Wait a minute.
Sheena fina file a tall fale garen we dar slew tar to the rani queen fay would face it shantir shincher fasta ni fog fur fetir on no faint trial anaka hain sovar nave lekien arkhil kan bash no se lekien arkhaya fe la wak na belir shale kani arang na fien.